Welcome to worship this third Sunday after Epiphany. I am Pastor Jonathan Boynton, and Pastor Martha Miller Sims will be preaching this morning. Let us gather this morning in song. Of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Almighty God, by grace alone you call us and accept us in your service.
Strengthen us by your Spirit and make us worthy of your call.
Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
A reading from Jonah. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, the great city, and proclaim it to be the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk. He cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he had a proclamation made in Nineveh. By the decree of the king and his nobles, no human being or animal, no herd or flock shall taste anything. They shall not feed, nor shall they drink water. Human beings and animals shall be covered with sackcloth, and they shall cry mighty to God. All shall turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Who knows? God may relent and change his mind. He may turn his fierce anger so that we do not perish. When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Mark, the first chapter. Now, after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God and saying, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord. What a mess Jonah makes of things. What he was afraid would happen did. He was afraid that the Ninevites would repent and believe God. He was afraid that God would forgive them. So he ran away when God called him to go to Nineveh, the great capital city of the Assyrians, who destroyed Samaria, and proclaim God's message of repentance. And even after the calamity of finding himself on the ship in the midst of a terrible storm, telling the terrified sailors they should throw him overboard, because God was surely trying to convince Jonah to turn around and do what God called him to do, even after the episode in the belly of the fish and being spit out on the shore, even after he finally heeded God's call and set out and went to Nineveh to do what God had asked him to do, even then, he didn't want what he feared would happen from the very beginning, that the people of Nineveh would repent and believe in God and that God would forgive them. Jonah is an unlikely prophet. He was disobedient to God and harbored such hatred for the Assyrians, he fought against God's mission. The story of Jonah has often been reduced to a discussion or an argument about how one could possibly live in the belly of a big fish, but that totally misses the point. Better understood as a parable, this story enables us to see parallels in our own lives and God's work in and through us to discover deepening faith and God's care and compassion for us and for others. Following our reading this morning in Jonah, we read about Jonah's reaction to God's forgiveness of the Ninevites. This was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed, "O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish in the beginning, for I knew that you are gracious, God, and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, Please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, is it right for you to be angry? Here in the last part of the story, we get to the point. God creates a bush to shelter Jonah, and he is happy. And then God makes the bush wither, and Jonah gets upset and again wants to die. God says to Jonah, is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And Jonah answers, yes, angry enough to die. God responds, you are concerned about the bush. Should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city in which there are more than 120,000 persons and also many animals? That's how it ends, with God asserting care and compassion for the people and even the animals of Nineveh. Jonah has made it clear he would rather die than see the Assyrians receive God's attention and forgiveness. This is a story about God's concern for the world God created, for every human being and creature, that God loves and will act with faithfulness and mercy for all. If it were up to Jonah, they would have been annihilated. Who are our enemies? Who do we fear? Who do we believe is beyond forgiveness or beyond God's concern? Like it or not, no one is outside God's concern and love. So the tribalism that we have seen in such alarming ways recently, still so much a part of our world, is not the way of God. White supremacy, the belief that one race of people is more valuable than all others, and the other ways we categorize human beings into groups and assert supremacy over them, us and them, is not the intention for God's good creation. It is not part of the Judeo-Christian way of life God calls us to live. It is disobedience to God. As we read the gospel accounts of Jesus' life and ministry, we find him embodying the love and mercy of God for all. We see it in his first actions in the gospel. Jesus came to Galilee proclaiming the good news of God, that God's kingdom has come near. Repent and believe the good news. Repentance is an act of faith, of turning around from the old way of living to the new, turning toward God and God's way, which is life. Unlike Jonah, Jesus is hoping that repentance and faith will be the response of those he encounters, religious leaders, fishermen, tax collectors, prostitutes, the wealthy and the poor, hungry, children, women and men, the sick and the injured. The new thing God is doing in the world, Jesus calls good news. As Jesus begins his mission to turn upside down the status quo of the world and especially the way the people of God have organized themselves and are functioning, he calls others to join him in that work. Simon Peter, Andrew, James, and John, all fishermen, engaged in what was for them normal everyday tasks, fishing and mending nets, see in Jesus something that gives them hope. And unlike Jonah, they immediately drop everything to follow him. It changes everything for them, and the world changes. We still live in the in-between time between Jesus' ministry, death, and resurrection, and the time when we will finally experience the peaceable kingdom envisioned in Scripture. I have to say that as we have been bombarded with news and messages in these last weeks, I am the most dismayed and saddened by statements and actions of people of faith who seemed to be missing critical information about Jesus' mission and his call to simultaneously love God and love our neighbors. We can disagree with one another, disagree with the other side, whatever that is, but we are always called by God to value other human beings and creation, to have respect for life, called to work for the good of other human beings and the whole creation so that all may thrive, not just survive, but thrive. Jesus didn't come for some ethereal vision of salvation or heaven. He came so that the world would be whole and well, so that all people would thrive in the knowledge of God's unconditional love and mercy for them. So as we hear the call to unity as a nation, we need to understand it as a call to be unified around care and concern for other people, for all people, for the common good. Our mission is to be God's partners in healing brokenness in our own time. In the midst of a terrible pandemic, God's call leads us to work and pray and advocate on behalf of those who are the most affected by COVID-19, to make sure that vaccines and health care is available to everyone, that those who work in medicine and other caregivers have the resources they need to be protected as they heal others. We repair the economic damage to workers and small business owners. We protect teachers and students and those who provide necessities for us. We wear masks and stay physically distant from others even after we get the vaccine for the protection of our neighbors. All these practical things are part of God's concern for people, God's work in our own time to make us whole. Christ's saving work is good news for the world and for us, as God's mercy was good news for the Ninevites and also for Jonah, even though he resisted it. God continues to call us to repent of the ways we have resisted God's mercy extended to others and to ourselves, and to believe the good news of God's salvation. This is the source of our hope. Amanda Gorman, the 22-year-old National Poet Laureate, read her poem on Inauguration Day, expressing a vision of a healed nation and a call to rise up in courage to live it together. We will rise from the gold-limbed hills of the West. We will rise from the wind-swept Northeast, where our forefathers first realized revolution. We will rise from the lake-rimmed cities of the Midwestern states. We will rise from the sun-baked South. We will rebuild, reconcile, and recover. And every known nook of our nation and every corner called our country, our people, diverse and beautiful, will emerge battered and beautiful. When day comes, we step out of the shade, aflame and unafraid. For there is always, the new dawn blooms as we free it, for there is always light. If only we're brave enough to see it. If only we are brave enough to be it. Amen.
Follow me if I but call your name. Guided by Christ, let us offer our prayers for the Church, the world, and all people in need. We pray for the Church throughout the world, that together we proclaim the good news of God's reconciling love in word and deed. We pray for our bishops, Elizabeth and Bob, and their staff members as they provide leadership in difficult times. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for your guidance for all elected leaders in our cities and around the world, that all may work for the common good, and especially for those who are vulnerable. Bring healing to our nation, an end to violence and racism, and help to those under economic hardship. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for those who are sick, distressed, or grieving, for the outcast and all who await relief, that in the midst of suffering, your peace, healing, and mercy surround them. We pray for Mary, Vicky, Bob, Jan, Karen, John, Donna, Jane, Bill, Brian, David, Jeff, Sean, Jandy, Jim, Dorothy, Betsy, Pete, Patty, Lara, and all affected by COVID-19. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We pray for our congregation and community, for the outreach ministries in which we are engaged, and for each other during this time when we are physically separate. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We give thanks for medical personnel, first responders, chaplains, and all caregivers, and pray for their health and for their families as they care for others. We pray for Dick, Scott, Lisa, Sheila, Rick, Julie, Dixie, Courtney, Nikki, Patty, Chris, Xavier, Cheryl, Cian, Eileen, Joe, Patrick, Linda, Sheila, Joe, Christy, Murad, Vicky, Kathy, Steve, Christopher, Krista, Becky, Gail, Deanna, Bill, Shanti, Stephen, Anna, Ron, Becky, Alexis, Jim, and Keith. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We commend to your gracious care and keeping all the men and women who serve in law enforcement and the armed forces at home and abroad. Protect and strengthen them as they protect others. Give them wisdom and courage to face the perils that surround them, and grant them a sense of your abiding presence. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. We are thankful for our ancestors in the faith whose lives serve as an example of gospel living. We pray for comfort for all whose loved ones have died, especially the family and friends of Donald, Timothy, Tim, Wynn, and the family and friends of Bridget Lehman. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken and silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Gathered into one by the Holy Spirit, let us pray as Jesus taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Lord, for thy tender mercy's sake, lay not our sins to our charge, but forgive that is past, and give us grace to amend our sinful lives.
May God, the Creator, strengthen you. Jesus, the Beloved, fill you, and the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, keep you in peace. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace, be the light of Christ.
Thanks be to God.